Good afternoon and welcome to Women on Wednesdays. April is Sexual Assault Awareness Month. It's not a new conversation on this campus or in this community, but it's a changing conversation, thankfully. So today, I want you to meet some foremothers in this community who are making a difference, a huge impact for victims of sexual assault. So I know my husband's going to be very proud because I'm going to push these buttons by myself. I usually don't, but here we go. I want you to see an overall view and some resources as we begin. Here is a website where you can get resources and more information about how you can get the word out in helping to change the conversation in this community about sexual assault. You can be an advocate as well. I think that we up here at the front are activists and advocates for the same reason most of us become either of those. Because something's touched us personally. Something in our lives has created a passion inside of us deep enough that we need to make the change. For me, I'm the mother of two daughters and the grandmother of two granddaughters. My youngest granddaughter is 7, my oldest granddaughter is 10. Now, I always fight the impulse to show you pictures, like most grandmothers do, but I opted out of that today because of time constraints. They're 7 and 10. We need to make some changes soon. So today, let's look at some numbers. This is what we know. 1 in 5 women and 1 in 71 men will be raped at some point in their lives. And I'm going to stop right here because I want you to know that this week I tabled an event to promote escape from rape. And a gentleman came to the table and shared his story. And he was in my age bracket, and we're not going to tell you what that is exactly. But he was in my age bracket, and he said in the 70s, he was in the military, and he survived a sexual assault. And so we listened, because he didn't fit the normal demographic of the stories we heard during the course of that day. We got some hugs, we got some stories, but this one reminded me that not all of the data has been collected yet, in part because changes in our culture, although they are happening, sometimes don't happen fast enough. And so we don't create a culture for every victim to feel comfortable enough to share their story. I'm going to let you read the rest of these numbers, and this is where I got this information. I always need to know that because then I can go back and look it back up. And because I want it to be a credible source. Phyllis taught me that. After you look at those numbers, the Tennessee Economic Council on Women came out with a report October 2013 to tell us the economic impact of violence against women. Look at that number. I am not a mathematician, but there are two commas in that number. In social services, law enforcement, judicial system, healthcare, workplace expense, productivity loss with unknown costs. Do you see how important that number is? Because it's in Tennessee. That's not a national number. That's not a global number. That's in Tennessee. The impact economically on victims and our society right here in Tennessee. Now, when I was growing up, my mom said, pick your friends wisely. You're known by the company you keep. So look at the front of the room, and I am honored to count these women as my friends. First, I'd like for you to meet Mickey Carter, the former mayor of Johnson City and one of the foremothers of Safe Passage. I like hanging with Mickey for a lot of reasons. She has the best stories of experience in the region, both politically and as an activist. She's done a lot of work. She calls us, we hop in the car sometimes, and she calls us grannies with no boundaries because we get in the car to make a difference and we're not going to get back out until we do. Our next panel member is Angelie Murray. She has a fascinating personal journey of her own. And so she is the founder and the executive director of Red Legacy Recovery. Stacy Larson is our third member. She's the executive director of The River that you're going to become familiar with in downtown Johnson City. Lynn Armstrong is the program director of Safe Passage. And last but not least, we have Cindy Humphrey, the victim advocate for the Department of Defense. Her office is located here locally. And I want to begin with Mickey, who just came in today and sat down and said, "Hey, what do you want me to tell?" And I've learned, don't script her. You'll lose something in that. So I'm honored to call her my friend, and I want you to hear some of the things she's done in Johnson City.
Well, unfortunately, there's a lot of things in Johnson City that I haven't done. And Ruth invited me here today, and she was extremely flattering. She flatters me to get me to. She says, "I'm inviting you, Mickey, because you're a dinosaur." I'm not kidding. That's what she said. But and she's right. I am. But the thing that we need to listen to people my age about is the fact that I wish I could talk to you about all the differences that I had made in my lifetime, but several of the battles that I thought had been fought and won have not. And as far as people's rights, just basic human rights, let alone women's rights, it seems like we're backing up, and I find that most disappointing. On the issue of abortion, in the 1970s, if a woman was on TennCare and that was taking care of her medical needs, the government would pay for up to 4 abortions. Now, I'm not pro going out and having 4 abortions, but, you know, they're trying to make it illegal now and make it as hard for a woman to have it as possible, let alone the government paying for 4 of them. And most women who get themselves in that situation and have to have one, as you all well know, they don't want that. But Ruth and I have been working. We met with our chief of police and started the sexual violence task force. And we have found that there are many, many holes and things that need to be done here in Johnson City. We call it connecting the dots, because we met so many people that didn't know anything about each other's services. And what we were there for was to try to make things better for the victim. And so that's basically what we've been trying to do for the last year with that task force. And Ruth is a dynamo. I mean, they could have gone on and said a whole bunch more things about her, because she is a worker and she's wonderful. And I hope one day we'll see Ruth run for public office. And that's going to be the next thing that I wanted to mention to you all. You need to vote, because I don't think people realize the importance of voting and voting for your best interests. Because I see so many people now, particularly and I'm not taking a side or trying to be partisan, but particularly in the Republican Party, I see people that vote against their best interests. People who don't have money, who don't have health insurance, and yet who are voting against all the things that could help them. Make sure when you vote that you know the facts. And, you know, and those are your facts, your truths, and then vote, because that is one of the most important things. Women as a whole across the United States are so underrepresented. 1993, the year that I was elected, was the year of the woman. And then they realized that women were coming on strong, and everything possible was done to keep that down. So, like I say, I wish I could tell you more positive things, but there's a lot of work to be done, and unfortunately, I think we're going to keep fighting those battles for a long time. Thank you.
What do you want me to share?
I want you to share at the intersection of sexual assault and your outreach with Red Legacy.
When I started Red Legacy 4 years ago, I had absolutely no idea what went on in the lives of women, especially in Upper East Tennessee. Absolutely no idea. I was in recovery from drug addiction myself, from a pain pill addiction, and that's all I knew, is that, okay, I've been through something. I want to help people that have been through the same thing and are needing some support systems. So October the 1st of 2012, I walked into the Carter County Detention Center to meet with all the inmates in there, all the females. I saw the top block and the bottom block, and my life completely changed that day for the better. As I shared my story of addiction and my history with the 50 plus women that were sitting in front of me throughout the day, I realized that we were all the same. We may have different education levels, different income levels, we were different colors, different, you know, ethnic backgrounds and religious views and all those things, but we all had the same situations going on, and that we were trying to stay in recovery from addiction or alcoholism. So that was very apparent. What I did not know and what I learned over the course of the next year, going in and out and in and out of there, meeting with them on Mondays, is that I never had anyone that sat in front of me that did not raise their hand when I said, please raise your hand if you're a victim of domestic violence or sexual assault. That was 100% for an entire year, actually for two solid years. There was not one female that sat in front of me and did not raise their hand. That's when I realized that, you know what? Addiction, domestic violence, sexual assault, sexual violence, whatever your term may be, go hand in hand. And I wanted to provide some resources on the outside of jail or prison for these women to come to and get help, support, and all those good things. Something that was super shocking to me was finding out that when these women left, well, when they were officially released from jail, number one, they...
I know what you're going to say.
What?
They can be released at midnight without a ride in Jonesboro, and they don't care. I've had women have to walk from Jonesboro to Johnson City at like 3 in the morning because they're released with no ride. They don't care if it's dark and she's not safe.
They have no idea, number one, what their plan is when they're getting to be released. That's number one. They don't have a plan, and that's something that we started to incorporate in our classes. But number two, when they open those doors and say, goodbye, you can go on your merry way, they have one of two choices. Well, one of three choices. They can walk wherever that they're going to go. Normally, they don't know where they're going to go, but they can start walking. They can call a family member or an ex-boyfriend or ex-husband or drug dealer, whatever, all of which normally are very unsafe choices for them because they got into the situation that they're in with these people. They were either manufacturing drugs together, using drugs together, selling drugs together, prostituting together. One of those things was happening. Or there's a family member that they could call, but that family member has custody of their children and they can get in legal trouble by being with that person. So that's no good. Their other choice is to call a cab or a taxi. And, you know, that would be my thought is, oh, just call a cab, get a taxi. Well, number one, they don't have any money. So the taxi drivers, and I'm not saying they're all this way, but many taxi people come to their rescue of the damsel in distress that's needing a ride, and they are asked to either trade sexual favors, drugs, or something of the sort for the ride. And at that point, I was just shocked. Had no idea those things occurred. And so after I heard that and was asking over the next Mondays going into the jail, how many of you have had to trade a sexual favor or do drugs with someone just to get a ride out of here to your destination, whether it was a safe destination or an unsafe one, just to get from point A to point B? And there again, it was about 9 out of 10. You know, that had a stroke. And so that's when I knew that my next goal for our program was to incorporate a transportation system. And with the help of the East Tennessee Foundation and Women's Fund out of Knoxville, we secured funding to buy a van and run our van 4 days a week to take women to court, probation, attorney, school, job interview, job, all of their relapse prevention and recovery skills and all those things, but also to pick up women at a jail, any local jail in Upper East Tennessee. They can call our van number and our van will go pick them up and take them where they need to go. So sexual assault and sexual violence was not on my radar in the beginning of starting this program. It was all about just addiction, but I have learned over the years that it all goes hand in hand, and I'm really thankful to be here and thankful to meet many of you that I've not met before, and thankful to see a lot of you that I have met before. So thank you, Ruth.
Thank you, Angelie. Stacy, when they are at the end of their ride, where do they end up?
Well, I'm director of The River, and The River is a ministry downtown in Johnson City. We've been there for 13 years now, and we serve women on two different levels. The very first level is basic needs. We are the place in Johnson City they can come in the daytime and be safe. We are the only place a woman can take a shower in the daytime. We have a snack. We don't do meals because within walking distance you can choose where you want to go and eat, whether it's Salvation Army or the Melting Pot or the Haven of Mercy. So we don't do meals, but we do snacks and we have a drink. But it's also just a happy place, a safe place, and we try to give non-judgmental compassion to the women that come in. So that's our first level of services. Second level is support services to help them to help themselves. So that includes we do daily devotions. Today's diaper day. I just left diaper day at the River. We have a diaper subsidy program. It's called Changing Lives from the Bottom Up. We give out around 4,000 to 5,000 diapers a month to kids, which is really significant. We have, that's one day too you might see men at the River, because we have diaper dads and we even have a diaper grandpa. So that's one of the things we do. We have free haircut day, we have a garden, we have a choir, we have just a lot of different activities, classes that go on that help the women to empower them and help themselves. So I work with a lot of women that are homeless and a lot of women that are low income, but today I really wanted to talk about homelessness and the issue of sexual assault. And I have some statistics, and I'm just going to focus on right here in Northeast Tennessee, because every year HUD requires agencies to do what's called a point and count time. You might see it on TV. It's always in January, and for a 24-hour period of time, these folks go out and they try to get an actual accurate count of people that are homeless, and that's defined by anybody that's living outside or in places that are not meant to be lived in by people. So my knowledge of it, that means under bridges. If you drive under bridges and you look up where that little overhang, you can see. If you go down by, you know, where Legion Street Pool is, before you get there along Main Street, if you look over past, once you kind of go down underneath the railroad, if you look over to the right, there's a huge tent city over there right now. They've got it all covered in black, so you kind of have to see it. The trees are starting to grow in now, so it's a little bit harder, but there's four huge tents over there, so they live anywhere, in cars, abandoned buildings downtown. So what they do in those 24 hours camps, they go everywhere and try to get an accurate count. Last year's count was 567 individuals in the seven counties that they counted here in East Tennessee, but Washington County was twice as high as any of the other counties. So I know that 2 years ago, Bonnie White, who's the homeless coordinator for Johnson City Schools, her statistics of children in Johnson City, we're not talking county, just Johnson City schools, had 750 children experience homelessness that year. That's more than would fill up Southside Elementary School. So it's here, right here in Johnson City.
And Stacy, can I add one thing to that? I did something with Family Promise, which is a local agency that keeps families intact. They informed me that the average age of a homeless person in Johnson City is 9.
Yeah, and the average age of death for a homeless person is 42. There's another number that's shocking. While there's no direct relationship between homelessness and sexual assault, I think it's important to realize that sexual abuse increases an individual's probability of becoming homelessness. And homelessness, if you are homeless, it increases your risk of sexual victimization. And these are going to be some really startling facts. According to this article that it's from the Journal of American Medical Women's Association, 84% of women that are homeless have experienced sexual assault or physical assault. 84%. 92% of homeless mothers have experienced sexual assault or physical assault. This is the one that kills me. The lifetime risk for violent victimization for homeless women with mental illness, which is, there's a large population of people that are homeless that are mentally ill, 97%. So what that does, it makes sexual violence a normative experience within that population. And it's true. And if you are homeless, they have found that compared to low-income women or other women, if you are homeless, there's an increased risk of violence in the sexual assault and multiple acts at the same time. So gang rapes, different violent things happening within that situation. I mean, that's frightening to me. And the reasons are because when you are homeless, whether you're a man or a woman, you're gonna sometimes feel like you've got to do things to get a place to live. I can't tell you how many women I talk to that will come in and they'll say, well, the guy told me all I'd have to do is clean his house and I could stay there and there's no strings attached. But by day three, there's strings attached that is sexual favors. I actually had an older woman who's homeless. She's mentally challenged. And she was staying with a man, and the first week was fine, but by week two, he said he had a new rule in the house. And she was somebody who was raised not to break rules. And the rule was that she had to have sex with him every day. Well, she came to me 3 days after this, so she'd been raped 3 times, but she didn't understand that she didn't have to follow the rules and had to get her out of that situation. I've had a woman just a week and a half ago who's staying at, I won't mention where she's staying at. She's not there anymore. She's in a better place, but it's a place that has shelters men and women in separate houses, not the same building, but separate houses. And she was talking to this guy that was working in the kitchen at this shelter, and they were kind of flirting and stuff, but then she kind of realized he was getting a little controlling and she backed off. Well, she was walking one night, he picked her up in the car, and he took her to Winged Deer Park and raped her in the car. 911 was called because there were witnesses who heard her screaming. And she was taken to the hospital, did the rape kit, he was arrested. The place that she was staying at, she was told that that guy would be kicked out, that she wouldn't have to see him, that he'd be gone, and that she'd be safe. And 2 days later, I guess he was released from jail. He was taken back in with welcoming arms, and guess who served this woman her breakfast that morning? Her rapist. So, she, of course, they didn't call and even say they'd done this. And so she, of course, is distraught and upset. And I had a very long conversation with the director of this facility, and he was blaming her because she had flirted with him. She was drinking that night, so it's her fault. And yeah. And then he even said that he'd seen her that morning making out with another man when she'd been with the police all morning and then with me at the river all morning. So just total blaming the victim. There are people out there that just have no idea. You know, the fact that she was drunk, that right there proves she can't give consent.
So but I'd like to interject something there real fast, too. If she was making out with another man that morning and it was consensual, which she wasn't, but it has nothing to do with the rape.
Yeah.
But that, Mickey, that reminds me of the original story you told me about what propelled you into starting Safe Passage.
Oh, I went on a tour of the Salvation Army. I'll just say it out loud. And I had just gone on to the city commission, and I thought we were handling the problems of domestic abuse in Johnson City, which I also don't like that word, domestic. It's violence. It shouldn't be domestic violence. It should just be violence against women, because if it was anybody but somebody you knew, they'd be put away for good. But when I went in and looked, they had these horrible little cots that looked, I've seen army cots that looked better. And now they may have improved all that. You know, I have no idea, but.
They're bunk beds now.
Yeah. Oh, okay. But they had pegboard up around this thing. And the door between the women's unit and the men's unit, the women's unit had a door that went to the outside, and they had taken a brick and propped the door open into the men's unit so those men could go outside and smoke, because God forbid that we would have kept them from smoking, even though these terrified women and children who have just been through domestic violence are in this section here, and these men are going to be coming through there while they're trying to sleep. And it was a horrible looking place, and I thought to myself, if I was a woman, I'd stay home and be beaten rather than take my children into a place like that, because at least at home you'd know the person that was beating you, and maybe he wouldn't hit the kids, you know. But that's how Safe Passage was started. And I'll go one further. The captain that they had then is not the same one that they have now, but he came to see me at my office and told me that I needed to drop that because they took in more donations from their women's center, from churches and so on and so forth, than they did from any place else. And he said, if you don't drop it, I'll see to it that you never get elected again. I will ruin you. And I said, well, you better get started then. Go ahead. And so we started Safe Passage, thank goodness. But I, you know, what you do is just so wonderful, all of you.
So, Lynn, children can stay with moms at Safe Passage, correct?
Yes.
Tell us about Safe Passage.
Well, just to repeat a little bit of what Mayor Farmer said, we opened our doors in 1996 and opened it to primarily serve women and children who are experiencing domestic violence or violence against women. And over the years, the program has grown. Basically, back during that time, there was really was not a lot of funding streams available.
No.
And so the most important and most critical thing was to have a place that was safe.
The original $30,000 came through HUD in Nashville.
Mm-hmm. Wonderful. And actually, the McKinney Minto Act had just been established in the 80s, and so there wasn't that much better. And I think Johnson City really was kind of the head of the bargain in this separate facility. And it's peaceful, it's serene, it's high security, and it is all of those things that you would want, but not want to hear as a prison. And I just think they chose the perfect thing. And as it continued over the years, I actually didn't join Safe Passage until 2005, and when actually the jail was closed. I was there until it closed. And so as I started involved in first and counseling and providing some assistance to the program, I began to realize that there was something less I liked to do and to continue that program. And how I got into it, I guess, is during the AIDS, our home began in 1980, serving as a domestic violence home in the state of Mississippi. It wasn't what I did for a job. It was what we did out of necessity, because unfortunately, we all know that that state typically is empty in a lot of different areas, domestic abuse services being one of them. So there were only two shelters in the entire state, and we were a female, especially female with children, most of the time we ordered back into the home with the kids. And so our home served as that until 1995. And when we moved here, it was a wonderful thing to know that Safe Passage. I actually met Linda Blaney when we first moved here, and I needed to do my children's room, and we needed to get rid of their furniture and that collar, and they came and picked up all the furniture we had to run while someone was moving out of shelter. The domestic violence piece, actually opened my eyes to the rape crisis situation in our country, our city, our communities. And a couple of years ago, we started looking at the holes and services and the gaps and services in the region. And as we did so, we asked survivors who came through the program if they had ever been forced to have sex against their will. An alarmingly high rate surfaced, and approximately 90% of the victims who came through our shelter had been sexually assaulted by their abuser, and in a lot of cases, other members, by order of the abuser, punishment. And we started to realize that we needed those services. Many times it does cover, it has such an impact on the family that it actually creates a safety tension. So many times leads to homelessness. It might not happen today, but come through some passage, but the failure to acquire and access the necessary services to assist someone to get on their feet and to deal with the mental health issues that are paralyzed as a result of that, typically do have devastating effects on the family, the children. The extended family often doesn't understand. Victim blaming becomes a huge caveat of what's happening. And if you imagine yourself being that individual who's having to deal with all of these services and all of the things that are happening in your life and the children's educational aspects start to suffer, it's really amazing that so many of these women, of the women who do survive, and they become activists, and they should, if they're able to do that, they really should, because there's no stronger voice than those who have been there.
Within the last year, haven't you received some sexual assault grants, some funding?
We did. As we began to address those gaps and services, we were fortunate enough to open up a sexual assault program that is limited to Washington County. However, if someone came to us, we would not turn them away. We would help them make connections with the agency that does provide services in their area. And the fascinating thing, or the reason that we decided to go that route is because, I don't know if anyone's aware of it, but Johnson City has the only same for sexual assault nurse examiners program in the region. And therefore, a lot of women and men who are experiencing this are going to come through Johnson City. So we partnered with Health Hospital Camp, and they actually provide a therapist and an advocate, and they serve more counties than we do. We got a very small amount of money, so we're very limited to the Washington County region. But, you know, so those of you, 84%, and talk about the homeless, because it's been through many studies, another 3 years, they actually have all come up with approximately the same percentage. 82% to 88% of rapes actually go unreported. And part of that is the lack of trauma-informed care in the region, the lack of how the situation is approached. I'm not going to go back to the service provider that runs, and we have to stop and think about it. And how we say what we say. The story that Stacey told, I hear that many, many times.
And she thought, she thought that she was at fault because she was drinking. And she even told me, I guess it's not a big deal because I was molested as a child for 4 years. And that just...
Dr. Judy Rice is the director of the Adult Day Center in downtown. And I took a tour of that center, and she told me something that I can't shake. In Johnson City, and maybe across the country, do you know one strategy a homeless woman uses to prevent sexual assault? She wears 10 pairs of pantyhose. Think about that. Think about living your life that way. As a student here on campus and as a staff member at ETSU, I come into contact frequently with those who served in the military. Last year, or sometime around that time, I was fortunate enough to become friends with Cindy, an advocate for the Department of Defense. Cindy, tell us what resources are available here in the community.
I'm the DOD victim advocate for this area. And my area is pretty large. It's like 14 counties. There's not many of us. We have to go through a rigorous training process. We have to do 32 hours of training every 2 years, 16 hours or 32 every two. And just like you said, we go through rigorous training so we don't re-victimize victims. Because blaming a victim is my biggest pet peeve. We actually go through role plays. Everybody gets a chance to be the victim. Everybody gets a chance to be the victim advocate. And I'm telling you what, sitting across the table from somebody, it takes a lot to be able to sit there and talk to somebody. And we do training every year with all of our military throughout the entire country. Every state has a SARC, which is a Sexual Assault Response Coordinator. And ours is in Nashville. And then there's, I don't remember how many of me there are within the state, probably 20 of us that are scattered throughout the state. And we get calls, we've got a victim need to go report. So we work with anybody that's had an ID card, still has an ID card, family members, and we try and help them get through. Like I work with Frontier Health, to get them counseling so we get to know the resources in our areas. We become the experts within our areas, so they have us plot all through the areas so we become the experts in our area, what's available for our people. But our main function is, the biggest part is education. We do education every month at every unit drill. Everybody gets an education, and especially this month with the Sexual Assault Prevention Month. This month is Eliminate Sexual Assault, Know Your Part, Do Your Part. We have all these little videos that we pass out, and we do videos with everybody. And it's all about bystander intervention is the biggest thing that we do every month with every soldier, so that they can know the clues and step in and help. And to that end, I've been doing victim advocacy since 2007. I was one of the first victim advocates trained in the state of Tennessee. I was one of the first ones. And I mean, I would do my training monthly, and then I have a great big one in April, and I have another one usually in September. We have really big ones, and there's just little ones monthly. And I had a soldier come up to me right before she was getting ready to get out of the military, and she came up to me and she said, "Sergeant Humphrey, I just wanted to thank you for your training. It really meant a lot to me." And something, the way she said it, the hair on the back of my neck stood up on the back of my neck, and I was like, "Come here a minute," because we were in a big bunch of people. And I pulled her aside and went into my office, and I said, "What's going on?" She goes, "Well, I've been listening to you for years, you know, talk about these classes, and I just want to let you know I appreciate you. Need to keep doing what you do because you really do help people." And then it really stuck up in the back of my neck, and I'm like, "What's going on?" Come to find out, 20 years prior, when she was active duty, she had been raped in Germany and never said a word. And she was supposed to get out of the military, and she had never deployed, which means she wasn't considered a veteran. So she wouldn't have been able to get any services. So I stopped, car wash, up here, not going anywhere, and I immediately called my SARC and said, "I got an issue." So we did a restricted report, stopped her from ETS, and she stayed an additional year, got this documented through the restricted channel, and now she can go to the VA. Where if she hadn't said anything to me, she wouldn't have been able to do anything. Because the Guard and the Reserve, if you don't deploy, you can spend 40 years in the military and you're not considered a veteran. They're trying to change that, but. So if you don't have something on your right sleeve over here, you're not a veteran. And so, I digress, but so that, it does work. The education does work. And I was blessed to be a part of the task force with Mickey and Ruth, and the first couple of meetings were very intense because the victim shaming was really rampant from the police force even, and that I had to get up and leave at one point because I was going to say something that might get me thrown in jail, so I had to leave and cool off and come back.
And we were playing on their home court too.
Yeah, and we were in their building, so it was really easy to throw me in jail. So, but we've come a long way in a year. We've gotten that animosity out, and we've come to a better place where we've been able to make policy and work from both sides and bring the resources, like you said, bring the resources together. They didn't even know I existed. And I've been here since 2007. So that speaks volumes of how many military people have been assaulted and they haven't contacted me.
None of us knew Erica existed.
Yeah, they didn't know Erica existed. They didn't know I existed.
And so if people had said, do you believe in Erica? We just said, no.
No. So it's all about getting the word out, getting the resources out, and to that end, there's also another function right here on ETSU on the 23rd of April in conjunction with OASIS from 1 to 3 in the afternoon. 702nd Engineer Company, it's the Army Reserve Group out of Gray, is putting on a resource fair all around sexual assault. Because we do a community event in April, so they're bringing out big trucks and stuff like that, the big old tent, sorry that, to get everybody to come, but they're going to be at the parking lot number 9, I think it is, the corner of University Park, which is in Franklin. They're going to have some trucks to get some people to come and see what we're doing. We're going to have Oasis out there. We're going to have Frontier Delta up here. We're trying to get
What's
all
that date again?
April 23rd. It's a Saturday from 1 to 3. We're going to have all the resources that are there from the military. We're going to have the resources there from the community partners. If you guys are available, you're more than welcome to come out and set a table up. But we want to have as many people as we can come out to the community from the community and just come see what we've got. We'll hand out flyers and pamphlets and whatever you got, all about sexual assault and domestic violence and all that. So I just want to put that out too. So that's going to happen. So that's me in a nutshell. It's all about education and working with the victim and getting them back to some sort of a semblance of normalcy, which takes a long time. So I do a lot. And with the military, I have different responsibilities. I have to give them their options before they talk to the police, because once they talk to the police, then their hands are tied and it has to be unrestricted. I get to them before the police, we can do a restricted report, and it doesn't get sent up to the chain of command. It's all non-identifying information. But if the police are called and they make a report to the police, then it's part of their reporting is taken away. And to the point of the gentleman that you brought up earlier, the statistics are even higher for non-reporting in the military, and the biggest reason for that is the stigma. For both men and women, especially men, there's hardly any reported in the military for men.
His discharge papers say PTSD, not sexual assault.
Yeah.
Because it was the 70s.
Right.
We don't have much time left, but I wanted to give you an opportunity to interact with some of my sheroes up here. So let's do a Q&A if you have any questions about any of the outreaches that you've heard. Yes.
I just have a question about the restricted and non-restricted reporting.
Yes.
How does that work as far as conviction?
The restricted and the non-restricted is through the military channels. Mm-hmm. So if it's a restricted report, it's non-identifiable information sent out just that there was one, but then there's no, the rapist goes free and there's no investigation. Unrestricted, then there's the police are called, and then there's an investigation started. Well, the restricted, they still get all the other services. They can go to the doctor, they can get mental health and all that. So the only thing that isn't done is investigation. And with that, they can still be stuck with that person in the same unit. And so because we don't, it's not being reported. Some people just want to get the medical piece done, and they get a safe exam done, and keep it on the shelf for a while, and then they can come back later and make it unrestricted if they want to. But once it's unrestricted, you can't unring that bell. So the unrestricted, then they start the investigation and they can actually move the person or the person, suspected perpetrator to the same unit if it's military. So that's what that is.
I want to make one quick comment on something that Lynn said about people not understanding what the families of victims of domestic violence go through and how it affects them. When we first opened Safe Passage, we had a 5-year-old little boy, and he was in there with his mother, and she would be sitting in a chair, and this child would literally attack her. I mean, he'd pick up something and just knock the dickens out of her with it. So we asked him, "Why are you doing this?" He said, "Well, Daddy's not here, and somebody needs to hit Mama." You know, so I mean, for anybody that doesn't believe it affects the whole family, it really does.
So where are we now? Where do we go from here? Mickey and I got in a car one day and we drove to Morristown because we found a SANE nurse. That's an acronym for Sexual Assault Nurse Examiner. They are forensically trained to to document a rape kit for a sexual assault victim. Understand that if they choose to prosecute, she is one of the key elements for testimony because her credibility cannot be questioned. Even physicians and regularly trained nurses can be called into question on trial because they aren't fully qualified to administer this kit, which was the word I was looking for. So Mickey and I got in the car one day and we had a meeting at this little side cafe. I don't even remember what it was called, but it was the Mountaineer. It was a Granny with No Boundary Day, and we were on a mission. And because of that mission, the College of Nursing is offering training for SANE nurses the last week in June here on campus. Without even trying, one of our cohorts and colleagues here on campus, Dr. Judy McCook, during one of her classes, just handed out a piece of paper and said, "Is there any chance anybody might be kind of sort of interested in taking additional training as a SANE nurse?" And she got 22 signatures. 22. That's a huge step in our local community for this future. This afternoon, when we go to the task force meeting, on the agenda, we're going to talk about what sort of curriculum could be implemented within the boundaries and the regulations of the Johnson City school system. Our children need to learn what a healthy relationship looks like. We need to be able to respond, maybe before it's too late. We have an outreach here of women who have been victimized and find themselves incarcerated. We have 2 outreaches here of women and families who are homeless, in part because of sexual assault. And we have a representative here to tell us stories from the military. Things are changing. As my sister, the English professor, likes to remind me, these are the best of times, these are the worst of times. Conversations matter, language matters, and they're changing, not quickly enough to suit us all, but at a pace that we can help propel with interest. So we've all become interested because of our own experience. We've all become interested in the question of, so what? So what if we do nothing? What becomes of them? And in turn, what becomes of us as a society and a community? There's one other person I want to introduce you to. Erica Shelton is a full-time staff member for the Sexual Assault Center of East Tennessee. It's located downstairs for now in Frontier Health. She's another resource. They have a hotline, and they have other resources, and she has information that she brought today.
I would love to pass them out.
She's going to pass them out. If you have any other questions for our panel, feel free.
Tracy?
Yeah.
You mean the statistics that you gave, 92% of homeless women, the 97% of women with mental illness who are homeless.
Do you want the studies?
So I'm wondering what recourses this population group has that's available to them.
Right.
there's really not a lot out there. And what happens is a lot of them don't report, so they're, if they're lucky, maybe they have a case manager at Watauga Mental Health, and so they can get counseling there. A lot of them just don't talk about it. They just kind of internalize it. And I've had the same experiences of sitting in a room and asking those questions and having every single person raise their hand. And I think finding other people that they can talk to about it helps, which is one of the things we try to do at the River, is we listen. We just listen without judgment. And I have figured out for myself that, I don't know what everybody's own personal spiritual beliefs are, but I'm a Christian, and I myself am a survivor of rape. I was raped while I was a college student. And, you know, at the time, you're like, why does this happen? Why me? And I know now that God has used that, because the second I share that with somebody who's telling me their story, that it happened to me, and they feel like they can talk more and share more. So just sometimes just finding and knowing you're not alone, and finding somebody that cares about you and can share with you. You know, we do try to send people to places to get assistance. Sometimes they just don't want to do that. But what happens a lot, and I didn't share this statistic, here's another numbers for you, but homeless women who have experienced either physical or sexual violence in the past month were 3 times more likely to report drug or alcohol abuse than homeless women who were not victimized. So that's what I see a lot of, people using drugs and alcohol to numb that pain.
I wanted to say something further back today when you were talking, you know, speaking about homelessness, that even though homelessness is recorded here if they're living in a place other, you know, something that's not humanly okay to live in, but what we find is we've got about 80% of our clients that are homeless. In my mind, homeless means, and I, this couch tonight, that car tomorrow night, neighbor the next night. And so it's a different place every night, or every 2 nights, or even every week. It's not necessarily under the bridge or whatever. And I really wish that the way that the documentation is taken would change, because, you know, having a Walmart bag with a toothbrush and a comb and one pair of underwear and no extra bra, I promise you they have one, and maybe, is all you have, and you go from place to place, that's homelessness. That is,
because you have, if there's an argument, you are out the door. You're not the one who gets to stay in the house with the couch.
They do not have a permanent address. There's no address. They say, what is your address? I don't have one. You know, that's being homeless.
And I can speak to that point. When we did point in time count, that our checks fit, just to give you an idea, we actually had 21 clients. Of the 21 that we were able to report, or we were not able to report, 13 of those were actually living with an ex-mother-in-law, an uncle, mother with my children. We could not count them as homeless because they had a place to sleep that night.
We were able to count 4, and all the other people we couldn't count, you know, so that it was a big issue for me. I was like, you know, on the phone.
We were able to count 8 hours.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's severely underreported.
Mm-hmm. There's a young lady back there that has a question.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no.
Oh, good.
That's good. We always talk about violence against women, and it's one of the major issues that's really why we're here today. But one thing I haven't heard mentioned is anybody servicing the LGBT community in our community. Violence happens against them every day, sexual assault, physical assault, everything. And I just wonder if there's either anything in the works, or is there something in your all's current programs that we can actually put out as a resource, information-wise, so they know that there are resources available for them in this area?
The data for LGBTQ sexual assaults is relatively new, and it's not anywhere near documented nearly as closely as violence against women, because until recently, the statistics were so lopsided and the violence against women was so much more prevalent, and we know it's because it was reported. LGBTQ community is just beginning to feel comfortable enough and accepted enough to report these instances. To my knowledge, they may know of a resource other than Heroes here on campus, but the Sexual Assault Task Force Committee, as far as I know, is not aware of any resources for that community in Johnson City.
For me, it doesn't matter whether
Yes.
I'm just saying, it doesn't matter. In fact, when we did our insurance this year, we wanted to make sure that it's known for the community. And so we did we want to make sure that we are against the community. We're working with John Baker and a group of individuals in the community to try to be culturally specific and ensure that we are not discriminating against anyone. And make sure that we're not discriminating against anyone. Over the years, I've served quite a few from the LGBT community. It's not well known because we don't advertise. It's a confidentiality issue, and different communities and different individuals don't want to advertise that. But we want everyone to know that we are open to providing services to anyone who experiences, whether it's sexual or domestic violence or both, a dual.
And I would also like to say that for the Sexual Assault Center,
yes,
we serve a variety of clients. The only restrictions as far as like advocacy, it's 13 and older, but therapies for any age. And it's therapies also for secondary, what we call secondary victims, which for example could be a mom that found out her daughter was raped. The mom can take that to process that. And the big misconception is through sexual assault had to happen recently, and that's not true. It could have happened a week ago, it could have happened 40 years ago. You can still take therapy from us. And our services are free. So I ask you that the Sexual Assault Center, please spread the word that we're around.
Whenever you say free, is that like a lower income kind of thing? There's like a.
What is that? No.
The victim does not pay anything, there's no like waiver to sign. We have some state funding. Me specifically, I'm under Victims of Crime Act, so I get funding from it. But we get many different donations. Our main center is in Knoxville, so they do a lot of fundraising and things of that nature. But it is free.
It is that magic hour. So I would like to thank the panel on several levels for spending the day with us. Thank you very much, all of you.